write down a little bit about reversible or irreversible processes. See, basically, the first statement of the second law of thermodynamics told us that we cannot have 100% efficiency. So now I need to find out, or we need to find out, if 100% efficiency is not possible, then what is the maximum possible efficiency of the heat engine? Okay, in order to understand what is the maximum possible heat efficiency, we need to understand what is reversible and irreversible process. Okay, so we have already learned about the quasi-static process. Quasi-static process is the process in which system is in equilibrium with the surrounding, okay, at every moment. So if surrounding changes, the system also accommodates with the surrounding slowly. Now the reversible and irreversible processes, okay, they are quasi-static process only. First of all, reversible processes are quasi-static process in which, please write down, reversible processes are the quasi-static processes in which the frictional losses are absent. I am telling you a very crude definition: no frictional loss. In a reversible process, there is no friction loss in a reversible process. Okay, so definitely when we are talking about the highest possible efficiency, we are going to take only those processes in which frictional losses are absent. Otherwise, every time a process happens, some part of energy will be lost due to the friction, and that cannot be reversed. If I trace back, the frictional losses will not be able to come back. It will be gone now. Fine. So that is the reason why we like to have reversible processes. Fine. So that is what is about the reversible processes. And then we are now going to discuss about the Carnot cycle. Okay, so Carnot cycle basically is the heat engine having the maximum possible efficiency. So Carnot was a person, he's a French engineer who was given a task by Napoleon to find out what is the maximum possible efficiency, and he came back with a quantification of the heat engine formula, all right, and that actually helps us to understand, you know, that how much maximum efficiency is possible. Otherwise, you know, if you don't know what is the maximum possible efficiency possible, then unnecessary will be comparing it with 100% efficiency. Suppose Carnot tells Carnot efficiency is, let's say, 50%, okay, then even if I build a engine which has 45% efficiency, it's a very good heat engine. But if I don't know that maximum possible efficiency is 50%, I'll think that 45% is a very bad efficiency, because 100% should be maximum, right? So that is why the discovery of Carnot engine is extremely crucial, so that it gives us a benchmark against which we can compare the efficiency of every other engine. Write down Carnot cycle. So please write down, Carnot cycle is the heat engine. Carnot cycle is the heat engine operating between two temperatures and has highest possible efficiency. Okay. Now, we know that the heat engine should absorb heat at constant temperature and release the heat at constant temperature. So the absorption of heat and the release of the heat should happen at the constant temperature. All of you agree this? Let's say that the higher temperature line is this, and the lower temperature line is that. So the cycle should operate between the two lines, these two lines, these are the two isothermal lines. Okay. Now I need to complete the cycle also. When it is absorbing the heat, it should expand. And when it is releasing heat, it should contract. But cycle should be completed. There should be a line from here which joins the line there. And from here, it should join there. What these lines should be? Anyone?
Adiabatic,
because the heat exchange is not allowed when you're going from here to there, or when you're going from here to there. Okay, heat exchange is not allowed. Heat should be only exchanged at the reservoir temperature. Please draw this. This is the Carnot cycle, and now we are trying to derive the efficiency of Carnot cycle. Okay, sorry, one small error we have made is that adiabatic will be below and isothermal will be above, that we have discussed already. So this is what the process will look like. Which is adiabatic? The lower one is adiabatic, okay? The up, this one is isothermal. So let's say over here, pressure is P1, volume is V1, and temperature is T1. Over here, pressure is P2, volume is V2, and temperature will be, what will be the temperature?
P1.
P1 only, it is an isothermal. So it will go like this. This is the cycle, Carnot cycle. This will be, let's say, P3, V3, and T2, let us say. This point will be P4, V4, and T2, because this line is isothermal, this one. And this is also isothermal, the upper one and lower one. Okay. Now I know that heat is exchanged at a constant temperature. So at a higher temperature, acha, by the way, which one is higher temperature, T1 or T2? Look at the diagram.
T1
is higher, right? Because P into V should be nRT. So multiplication of pressure into volume will be highest at the upper portion, lower in the lower portion. So heat is absorbed there. So you can draw in the diagram like this. So this is Q1, and heat will be released at this temperature, T2. T2 is a reservoir temperature. So you can say this is Q2. Okay. And we have already arrived at this expression that efficiency will be equal to 1 minus Q2 by Q1. Okay. Right. Now, what I'm trying to find out here is that what is the efficiency in terms of T1 and T2? Okay. So all of you, please tell me what is the value of Q1 equals to and Q2 equal to. Think over it and let me know. It is an isothermal process. Okay. 1 to 2 and 3 to 4 isothermal process. So Q1 and Q2 find out. See, it is an isothermal process. So if you apply first law of thermodynamics between 1 and 2, delta U will be 0, change in temperature is 0. So delta Q will be equal to work done of the isothermal process. Work done in the isothermal process will be nRT1 log of V2 by V1. Isn't it? This is delta Q, which is my Q1 only. Right. So Q1 is NR T1 log of V2 by V1. Now tell me what is Q2? Q2 is what?
Minus NRT ln V4 by V3.
See, actually it should be final volume divided by initial volume only. Q2, if you find out, it will be NRT2 log of V4 by V1. V4 by V3, sorry. But I know that this quantity is negative. Getting it? But in the expression, I already know that Q2 is released. Okay, and when I substitute in this relation, Q2 should be made positive. That is why there is a minus over here. There should be NRT2 log of V3 by V4. If you take V4 by V3, that is not wrong because the heat released should be negative. But when I substitute here, I already know Q2 is heat released. I want to know how much heat is released. So you should put a positive number over there. I hope it is clear to all of you. NRT2 log of V3 by V4. So efficiency can be written as 1 minus NRT1 divided by NRT2 log of V2 by V1 divided by same natural log of V3 by V4. Okay. NR and NR gone. So I can say it is this 1 minus of that. Okay. Now tell me, have we used till now the fact that 2 to 3 is adiabatic and 4 to 1 is adiabatic? Have we used that till now?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No. So let's try to use that. How can we use that? Where should I write? Okay, this small space. All right. So for adiabatic, P into V, gamma is constant. I want the relation between volume and temperature, because temperature and volume are correlated here, and the expression also temperature and volume is there. So that's why I want between temperature and volume. I know that P into V is equal to NRT. Okay. So P is equal to NRT by V. So that into V to the power gamma is constant. And that's the reason why T into V to the power gamma minus 1 is constant. N into R is anyway a constant. So that into constant is another constant. So for adiabatic process, T into V raised to the power gamma minus 1 is a constant. All right. Now I'm going to apply this equation, TV raised to the power gamma minus 1, between 2 and 3 and 4 and 1. So what will be the equation? If I apply between 2 and 3, I'll get what? Temperature at point 2 is what? T1. So what will I be writing there? T1 into?
V2 gamma minus 1.
V2 gamma minus 1 is equal to what? T2 into
V3 gamma minus 1.
Gamma minus 1. This is between 2 and 3. Between 4 and 1, what can I write?
V2 V4 gamma minus 1 is equal to T1 V1 gamma minus 1.
Correct. T1 V1 gamma minus 1 is equal to T2 V4 gamma minus 1. Okay. Now, if you divide this first equation, I am intentionally writing here only so that everything is visible. Otherwise, it will not make much sense. So there are two equations. If you multiply left-hand side of this equation with the left-hand side of that equation, T1 is gone. So you're going to get V2 by V1 raised to power gamma minus 1 is equal to V3 by V4 raised to power gamma minus 1. Okay. So this is what you're going to get if you divide it. V2 by V1 gamma minus 1 is equal to V3 by V4 power gamma minus 1. So gamma minus 1 power, if you remove, V2 by V1 is equal to V3 by V4, right? So that's the reason why this can be cancelled away from that. Have you understood, all of you?
Yes.
Okay. So efficiency of a Carnot cycle can be simply written as 1 minus T1 by T2. Sorry, T2 by T1. Where T1 is the hot reservoir. Oh, I have. Actually, numerator should be this T2 with the numerator and denominator got exchanged. Please correct that silly error. So this is V2 by V1. Still, it will cancel out numerator and denominator. You'll get 1 minus T2 by T1. T2 has to be colder reservoir, otherwise T2 by T1 will become greater than 1 and efficiency will come out to be negative. So that is, I mean, that's another way to remember the numerator should be lower than the denominator when you write the temperatures. Okay. So towards the end, a small proof is there. Just 5 minutes I'll take to prove that Carnot cycle has the maximum possible efficiency. Okay. The proof of Carnot cycle being the maximum possible efficiency is done by contradiction. They assume that suppose such cycle exists, which gives more efficiency between the two temperature than Carnot cycle. So let's say T1 you absorb the same amount of heat, okay, and you are able to extract more work, okay, but then you are releasing the same amount of heat, T2. Please draw this two cycles, Q1 dash, W1 dash, and Q2. This is original, and this is Carnot, and this claims to have more efficiency. This cycle, let's say, claims to have more efficiency than Carnot. If, okay. So basically, you are able to convert, actually it should be W1 dash and Q2 dash. You're absorbing same amount of heat, but you're extracting more work. All right. So basically W1 dash should be greater than W1. This is what it means for the same Q1. All right. Now, if this is true, then both should be reversible. One and two reversible. So I can reverse the cycle one. I can reverse the original Carnot cycle, and this is how it will become. It will become a refrigerator now. T1, and now it will give the heat back, but it will need work to be done now. It will take heat from the colder reservoir, T2, and this is Q2. See, we already know Carnot cycle is reversible. So I reversed it. Okay. So Carnot engine becomes a refrigerator, right? And then I'm coupling 2 and 3. When you couple 2 and 3, then basically whatever is a heat, this Q1 and Q1, you can couple, and this W1, which is work done on this cycle, can be taken from this modified cycle. All right. So entire cycle will become like this. T1. This is little tricky to understand, so it will take time to sink in. But initially, someone need to tell you entire thing first. So this is T2. This will be Q2 minus Q2 dash. Okay. And this will be equal to W1 dash minus W. Okay, so clearly W1 dash, we already assumed is more than W1. So W1 dash minus W1, W1 dash minus W1 should be greater than zero. Okay, and since more amount of heat in the modified cycle is converting into work, Q2 dash should be less than Q2. So that is the reason why even Q2 minus Q2 dash is greater than zero. So now if you look at this, what is happening here? What is happening here is that you're taking heat from the colder reservoir. Okay. You're taking heat from the colder reservoir and converting entire heat into the work, and you're not rejecting any heat. Is that possible?
No, sir.
Sir, can you just repeat that last thing?
What I'm saying is that ultimately when you couple the modified cycle with the reverse of the Carnot cycle, what comes out is that you're extracting heat from a colder reservoir, okay, and converting entire heat into work. That is against the second law of thermodynamics. So that is the reason why there cannot be heat engine which has more efficiency than the Carnot cycle. Okay, so this is this proof is done by contradiction. So that's why it will be a little tricky to understand. You just need to spend a little bit more time to visualize what has happened. Sir, all right, so
sir, coupling means like we are adding the two engines and adding the heat energy taken in, taken out the work and all, sir.
Coupling means whatever work is required by the reverse Carnot cycle is taken from the modified Carnot's engine, which has more efficiency, and the whatever heat that is supplied to the modified Carnot engine is taken by the reverse Carnot, is given by the reverse Carnot engine. So what this earlier, what was happening is that reverse Carnot engine was giving heat to T1. Rather than giving to T1, the same heat can be taken directly by the modified Carnot engine. So that is what coupling means.
Okay. So, so the one in the blue box is the net engine of both of them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So the modified engine is doing work on the reverse Carnot. So
modified engine is doing work on the modified engine. You can't say it is Carnot or not. It is combined. There cannot be any process. It doesn't talk about engine. There cannot be any process whose sole result is to convert heat into work completely. Does not matter if one engine, two engine, five engine. does not matter. All right.